high-tech falling out of the sky? Is this true? Yes, 3,000 times each day around the world. And it can be a lot of fun to hunt this fallout. With a LoRa module, a Raspberry Pi, and an RTL-SDR dongle. Come with me on a drive through the night and learn how you can experience such adventures too. Maybe with your kids? Grüezi YouTubers, here is the guy with the Swiss accent, with a new episode and fresh ideas around sensors and microcontrollers. Remember, if you subscribe, you will always sit in the first row. Starting weather balloons with some radio equipment is cool. For example, to produce world record distances with LoRa. The effort for such a launch is high and the cost too. What if government would sponsor these launches? Would that be cool? This is precisely what happens. According to Wikipedia, there are around 1,300 launch sites, and they launch balloons at least at 11 and 23 UTC. So every day, around 3,000 balloons to chase. Cool! And here you see them flying all over Europe. So in this video, we will cover things like: what do these balloons measure and how do they work? What technologies do they use? All nice, but more interesting, we will hunt them. I will show you how to build a simple tracker to search for them and a surveillance station for long-time monitoring if you are interested. Let's start this exciting journey, and together we will go on a hunt or two. When I got this message from Peter, one of my viewers, that a weather balloon will soon fall on my head, I remembered that chasing those weather balloons was for a long time on my bucket list. Now it was the time to start the project. Balloons are used for atmospheric sounding. They profile temperature, humidity, wind speed and direction, and other parameters. The data is used for weather forecasting. Their measurements are transmitted over the air and, therefore, can be heard by everybody. Two frequency ranges are used, around 403 and 1680 MHz. I will concentrate on the 403 MHz band used around here and leave you a link for the US viewers. In the US, there are also nearly 100 launch sites. Unfortunately, it seems to be a little less comfortable to hunt balloons in the US, but maybe this video will trigger some actions to make it simpler there too. The same applies to Australia, where they also have plenty of launch sites. A few other things a hunter has to know. The balloons are made of latex and are filled with hydrogen or helium. They climb relatively fast and usually burst at above 30,000 meters. Then they start to descend on a parachute and still travel a long distance till they land somewhere. If we want to find them, we need two essential things: a prediction if a balloon is heading in our direction and when it will be launched, a receiver to decode the signal, especially its position. The closer we know the position of the landing, the easier we will find it. And we can decide if it's worthwhile even to start a recovery attempt, as we will later see. Let's start with the first point. To make a prediction, we need a list of balloon launch facilities around our home or holiday location. Balloons can travel 100 kilometers and more. For these 100 launch sites, it is easy to get predictions. Radiosondy.info assembles all needed information around past, current, and future flights, including the type of the sonde and its frequency. And it maps the data on OpenStreetMap. Here you see all covered launches for the next few hours, for example. If I zoom in, I see that I have a chance to get balloons from maybe four launch sites. The closest, Bayern, is less than 100 kilometers away. As we see in Peter's message, three balloons have the potential to land in my area. The rest is going in other directions, and I do not want to drive too far. The first launch will be at midnight today, so I have to hurry up to build the rest of the needed infrastructure. In the old days, they were not able to decode the messages. So they used a portable receiver and a directional antenna to triangulate and find the balloon. This was not easy, especially at night. And because the radio sond battery is not too big, it only emits a signal for a few hours. Today it is much easier because we can decode the signal and use the built-in GPS of the radio sond. If we have a receiver for the Gaussian frequency shift, short GFSK, modulated packets sent around 403 MHz, and decoding software, we always know where the balloon is, at least as long as we can receive its signal. Easy! The frequency is very close to 433 MHz, and our LoRa chips can also receive GFSK. So we only need software to do so. And such software exists. Its name is MySondy Go, programmed by two Italians. We only have to flash a bin file to a 433 MHz TTGO LoRa board, and ready is the receiver for the weather balloon data. No big antenna, no SDR receiver, just a TTGO LoRa board with a display. And there is even a companion app for Android smartphones, which displays our and the balloon's position. After an hour or so, I had my balloon tracker prototype connected to a power bank. I'm sure this will be very useful in future hunts. Let's check it out. It is already after midnight and the balloon in Payern should already be in the air. Right from the outside of my house, I hear the balloon on 403.5 MHz using a general-purpose baofeng. And my freshly built balloon tracker also blinks the green LED, the sign for a reception. It displays the number of the radio sond and its position. And the smartphone app shows its position in OpenStreetMaps. Super! In the beginning, the balloon follows its predicted path, but suddenly it changes its direction. On radiosondy.info, we can follow its track, and a real-time simulation determines its landing point. It becomes more and more apparent that it will land in less than 10 kilometers distance from me. It's now after 1 a.m., and I cannot resist. I have to find it. Short check, what do I need? My new tracker, including the power bank, the smartphone, light, and, very important, rubber boots, because it most probably will not land on the road. So I drive into the night. In the meantime, Peter reported over WhatsApp that the balloon landed in a gravel pit in Germany. A network of surveillance stations was able to track it nearly till its landing, so it should be easy to locate. But gravel pits are private ground. Around 1 kilometer from the predicted touchdown point, my tracker started to blink. I sign it got the real position directly from the radio sond. Very good. And really, as predicted by radiosondy.info, it should be at the end of the gravel pit on the other side of the railroad. Hopefully, no train will pass at this night time. You remember the rubber boots? Now I mounted them because it was raining the whole day, and I tried to get to the balloon. You see, it was very dark. Unfortunately, the direct way was not the best, and a high fence made it impossible to enter. I was just a few meters away and had to return to my car. But long-time subscribers know that I do not give up, even in the middle of the night. I tried it from another position, and here, after searching, I found a small hole in the fence, big enough to enter. Now I was in, and after a short walk, the balloon appeared in front of me. It was easy to recognize because it was more or less intact. I remembered that it only reached about 17,200 meters, so it did not burst as usual. The balloon, by the way, is perfect for latex lovers. It smells exactly like that. But as a nerd, latex is not my interest. I wanted a radio sond. There is a long cord between the balloon and the sond, so it should be easy to find. And really, I found it. but with all this excitement, forgot to press the record button on my smartphone. By the way, you have to take a Swiss Army knife to cut the cord off with you. I learned this the hard way one night later. Now I can start my return. Hopefully, I will find the hole in the fence and my car. Fortunately, everything went well and I arrived in our garage at nearly 4 a.m. So I had beginner's luck on this successful first mission. A short sleep followed. Because the next balloon was predicted to land close to me too, I wanted to finish the second part of my project. My own surveillance station for weather balloons. There are many such private stations connected to the radiosondy project, but none close to where I live. So mine would come in handy if the next balloon lands in my vicinity, because it would provide data close to the landing position. A surveillance station consists of these parts: a Raspberry Pi, an RTL-SDR dongle, an antenna, and some software. This station should automatically receive data from nearby weather balloons and send it to the radiosondy.info page. If you register on radiosondy.info and fill in some information, an image is generated for you to download and burn using Raspberry Pi Imager. By the way, you can attach up to 3 SDR sticks if you want to cover the whole frequency range. Because I only wanted to cover radiosond from Payern, I start with 1 stick, and I use an old Pi 3 Model A, mainly because I have it laying around, and it has a small footprint. I did not try a Pi 0 because I do not like its limitations. Maybe it would work too. After flashing the image, you can connect the Pi using the VNC viewer on another PC. The only thing left is to calibrate your SDR receiver. It uses nearby 900 MHz GSM stations to do so. Innovative idea. Use what you do not have to pay for. Now my surveillance station is ready too, right before the start of the next balloon. Now we have time to look at the radio sond. Here we see a sensor and here the antenna. Let's start with the outside sensor. It is absolute high-tech because it has to withstand extreme conditions. At 30,000 meters in the rain and fog. If we look at this particular sond's specification, we see that it uses a very precise platinum resistor which works up to minus 95 degrees Celsius. The humidity sensor is a thin film capacitor, so we can assume that there is a lot of know-how in this small sensor plate. But what's inside the styrofoam box? If we open it, we see a dual-sided PCB with lots of vias for a proper ground connection. The sensor, as well as the antenna, are connected to this PCB. On the other side, we see 2 AA lithium batteries. I assume they are used because they are lighter than standard AA batteries and have a working temperature to down to minus 40 degrees Celsius, which is not enough for the minus 50 degrees at 30,000 meters. This is probably why they use styrofoam for insulation. This RS41SG sond does not have a pressure sensor populated. It seems to use the U-Blox GPS chip for altitude measurement. As I showed in video number 22, this measurement is not exact. That is why it sometimes reports descending rates during the climb. Of course, this GPS chip also determines the location of the sond and so eases our search. The CPU is a standard STM32F100 chip. This enabled some projects to hack these sonds. So you can change its frequency to the 433 MHz range, where you can use it for your own weather balloon. I leave a link to some hacker projects. You do not need to solder. This connector, which is probably used by the launchers to store the number and the frequency, is also a programming interface. The radio chip is a bread and butter transmitter chip which outputs up to 20 dBm or 100 milliwatts. After my first success, I tasted blood. The next balloon also was forecasted to land in my direction. It landed short and it was quite clear that its touchdown was in a forest. But you never know, and I started the hunt again. now with the support of my newly built Raspi, which already contributed its data to the community. I also printed a small case for my tracker and a battery. Very handy and neat. Because the balloon's touchpoint was on a mountain, its signals were still received by the network after landing, so I knew its exact position even without my tracker. As you see, the weather was terrible, the hill extremely steep, and in the end I discovered what I already knew. I was standing precisely below the balloon, but did not see it because it was high up in one of those trees. This time I had to go back without a trophy. This is why I tried it a third time, also during the night. And I was successful again. The balloon was on the floor, and the sond also hung in a tree, but reachable. Here is where the Swiss Army knife would have been handy. The cord is tough to tear apart. This is the reason I have two RS-41 sonds on my table. And here are the two balloons. The first is entirely intact, the second only in parts. And here we see the parachute, which should have softened the fall. Unfortunately, this one did not open correctly, and it fell quite fast. And here it is still inside the balloon. Now it's up to you to start the search or to build a surveillance station. And if you want, you can enter the Hall of Fame on radiosondy.info because you should enter your name if you found a balloon. Search for HB9BLA and you will find my two catches. Still at the bottom of the list. As the last step, I built a permanent housing for my Raspi and the SDR receiver. I used the same assembly as for my LoRa gateway with a tube from the do-it-yourself shop and a 3D printed holder. Because it will run off mains, I included a small power supply. And I added a do-it-yourself ground plane antenna, which I optimized using a vector network analyzer and pliers to cut it to the right length. This antenna is okay for the 100 kilometers to the launch site. Maybe we will meet once hunting for the same balloon. Hopefully not during the night. Meeting somebody in the middle of the night in nowhere can be scary. So if you hear somebody near you, just shout, "Hello guy with a Swiss accent," and I know that I have nothing to fear. As always, you find all the relevant links in the description. I hope this video was useful or at least interesting for you. If true, please consider supporting the channel to secure its future existence. Thank you. Bye.